All right, so it's been a long day. Thanks for sticking to the last session. I thought that today I was going to talk to you about a simulator that we have been working in recent years to understand diffusion across networks. So this is a shiny application over R coded entirely by my RA, Antonio. And I can tell you that he is not going to answer your requests as quickly as Vincent on new things that we want to add. In fact, this is very embryonic work. This is not going to be as radiant as radiant. But we are also trying to understand if there's enough traction so that we can keep investing our effort and our time on this platform. So the idea here is that there's many courses that look at networks and include some element of network analysis, both at the undergrad level and at the graduate level. And there are three topics that are typically of interest to both faculty and students. One is to understand and visualize network properties. Another one is to visualize how products diffuse across networks. And the third one might be to actually put the first two together and try to understand how network structures affect product diffusion. So we have been trying to develop this software to address these three things. So the software that we have has the following features. It allows users to create networks by hand or by construction. I'll explain in a little bit what that means. You can define parameters that shape the diffusion process, so a la Bass model. You can define initial conditions, run simulations, and observe diffusion. So this touches upon a number of things that we talked today, from what Anzana just discussed to what Florin discussed in the morning about centrality measures. The software offers an end-to-end environment, so you can load stuff, you can save stuff, and then load stuff, which is helpful if you want to do several sessions on network analysis. You can save stuff and come back, and this is you have the full state available to you, and you can keep progressing from 1 week to the next. So this has been used in a course that I teach at Heinz called Managing Disruptive Technologies. It's a core course in our MISM program, Master of Information Systems Management. And we have about 220 students per year. They work with the simulator for one homework and in class in teams of 4 or 5 people. So this is pretty much the setup that is available to the students. Let me jump into exactly what we're talking about here. And again, I'm going to try to sell you on how easy it is to use this. This is the kind of text file that you need. So here I'm essentially saying that I have one node called node 1 in community 1. I have node 2 in community 1. I have node 3 in community 1, and so on and so forth. So here I'm creating a network with 9 nodes. And then I'm saying I have an edge from node 1 to node 2, from node 1 to node 3, and so on and so forth. So the quiz is, what type of network is this? Star, right, yes. And when the students input this as a text file and the software shows us this picture, they start getting relaxed. Okay, something is going well. I mean, I really understand what's going on. So this is typically one of the cases that we want to look at. We want to look at stars and rings, more complex structures, typically at imperfect combinations of stars and rings. So the software will show you this plot, and it will compute automatically for you a bunch of measures of centrality, like degree centrality, closeness, betweenness, eigenvector. And my perception is that in the class, this is easy for students to understand what's going on, because when the students give this graph to the software, they see this picture and they see these measures of centrality, it's very clear that there's a node that is more central. And then you can start talking to them about what the central mean. Is it degree? Is it closeness between us, eigenvector? Sometimes these measures not always agree with each other. But you can see here that there's a node that is clearly very different from the other ones, and everybody else is the same. Right? So all the other nodes are similar. And this is, at least in the classes that I'll be teaching, this is an easy way to convey the fact that, that there is in the star there's a central node and everybody else is the same. You can also do a ring very easily as well. Again, 9 nodes. You have edges from 1 to 2 to 3 and so on and so forth. So very quickly, the students realize this is a ring network. And then again, the software will, for any network that you input, will compute the centrality measures. And it's very easy to understand that there's no central node here. And then you can do that visually, but you can also do the math. And you can see that everybody is the same in this kind of network, right? No matter what centrality measure you're looking at, everybody in the ring network has the same values for decentrality measures, and all nodes are similar. So the software will, for any network, compute these centrality measures for you right away, and that allows you to understand network properly. So this is the interface of the simulator. The first part here, you can create a graph or load a graph from a file. So you have two topologies that are available to create graphs at this point, the Erdős-Reni topology and the Barabási-Albert topologies. You can choose how many nodes you have in the network, the probability for the edge, and the software will create one network for you. Or you can just load the network from a file, as I just described before. So here in this case, I'm uploading from a file that I have a little bit more complex network. You can see that the software will plot the network for you. And it's visually interesting because when the students look at this, they clearly look at this network and they find, oh, here I have a network that was created based on four different communities. And these communities that have different structures, right? And so we have two communities here that are essentially random graphs. And visually, random graphs, as we know, are very different from preferential attachment. And random graphs and preferential attachment reflect different structures and different types of behaviors, and we can talk about that in class. And when the students look at this, they understand, oh, I understand what is preferential attachment and how that is actually very different from people randomly bumping into each other. And so this is the example that I have been using in homework for a few years in a row now. Then, in order to try and understand how diffusion occurs, the next thing that we are going to do in this software is, once I have a graph, who do I want to gift the product with to begin with? So the idea here is that we're going to target the product to a few people, and then we're going to see how that diffuses. And then I'm going to ask the students, can you actually find the subset of initial targets, the initial condition that is going to maximize diffusion? That's going to be the goal. So you can define targets at random if you want, or you can load targets from a file. So in this case, I load targets from a file, and the software will show you that these guys are endowed with a product at time zero. Okay? So I just chose those IDs to have the targets to begin with. And so after we have a graph and we have targets, then we can run a simulation. And what the simulation is going to do to you is going to start spreading that product from those targets according to some diffusion parameters. So the parameters that you can play with in this simulator are the innovation parameter, the imitation parameter, and the influence parameter. Okay? So I thought it would be very weird that all of us go through a full day of conference without an equation. So here is one, at least one equation today, which is your traditional probit model. You have the innovation parameter, the intrinsic likelihood to adopt the product, typically related to mass marketing activities. That's how I introduce it in class. Then you have this imitation parameter that depends just on the total number of adopters, and this allows us to talk about network externalities. And you have a local version of this, which I call the influence parameter, which is how your friends that have adopted the product incentivize you to adopt the product. And then you can talk about word of mouth and so on and so forth. So you have these three parameters that you can play with, and the simulator will allow you to understand how tweaking these parameters will change the shape of the S-curve and in the speed of diffusion of the product. So you can define these three parameters, and just to give you an idea of what is that I've been doing with the students, I have a homework that I start with them in class, and then they pursue the homework further in the next week on their own. I tell them, here is a network, and I tell them, take into account that the network is actually four communities with different structures. Set the innovation parameter to -2 and the imitation parameter to 0. Essentially, I'm fixing these two parameters. I'm just interested in this part of the course to understand how changing the influence parameter changes diffusion. So I keep these two fixed. And I tell them, choose 8 targets, 8 people to give the product to maximize profit from sales in this network. So that's the question. And this is a point in time in the course in which we already discussed network properties, centrality, different types of centralities, and so on and so forth. And what I'm telling them is, can you find a strategy to choose 8 people to endow with a product that is going to maximize your profits, irrespective of how much is the influence? Even a strategy that works for a small word of mouth effect and for a large word of mouth effect. Because if you're not able to measure how much is the peer influence, then you should have a strategy that works well no matter the magnitude of the word of mouth. And the first question in the homework is, if out of 400 people you have to choose 8, how many combinations are there? 1.5, 10 to the 16, so that the students understand, okay, I'm not going to try all of them, right? Yes, Sanjeev? No, the network is fixed. The network at this point is fixed. We can think about that. Yes, that's how this network was created in the first place. But now, as the product diffuses, I don't let in this software, as of now, I don't let the network to change. We can think about that in the future. But the network is the set of everybody in the market and their connections. And what might happen is that people will create connections because of something that is going on, but then we need to define that process as well. No, this is just a tool to show how diffusion occurs based on these parameters. Okay, it's not to study that after we look at it. This is to visualize diffusion and to understand diffusion. So again, the goal is, If diffusion is defined by these parameters, how much is imitation, how much is network externalities, how much is word of mouth, this is how things are going to diffuse from an initial set of consumers that get the product. Can you find a set that makes most sense? And there's always a visual intuition for what the students do, and then they can look at the simulations as well. Here, clearly, what's going to work well is maximum local degree. As Florin was mentioning in the beginning, they get over the idea that if I give the product to the node in the network that has more friends, that might not work. That might not be the best. In fact, here, because we have these four different communities, if we don't put targets in every community, so some communities will not get the product no matter what you do. Because if I put all the targets here, it's very hard for the product to get there. So what we're trying to explain to the students here is that you need to look carefully at the structure of the network, exploit the structure of the network, and so introduce them to this idea of maximum local degree. And it so happens that in this network, if you look at global highest degree, they're all in the same community, and it's not going to work if you just look at degree. You need to look at other measures of centrality. I also tell the students that they need to run several simulations. This is a stochastic simulator, so if you run just one simulator and you get a very good result, might be just luck, so you need to actually run like 10 times and average the results out. I ask them to do that in the homework. And this is what you can see from the simulation. So what the software is going to show is, for any point in time, who has adopted the product with the red dot. So for example, here we have, for a simulation with a small influence parameter and for time equals 10, you can see here these were the guys that were endowed the product at time zero, and these are the people that got the product afterwards. So you can essentially slide and see how things go. And the students, of course, are very creative and can do a movie out of this very, very quickly. So you can see here, as time goes by, what happens. You can see here, if I change the influence parameter from a small number to a medium number to a big number, you have all these different levels of diffusion. The software will also show you the S-shaped curves. And so here I use this picture to tell the students that usually we are looking at an S-shaped curve in the diffusion of products, and they read bus model paper and so on and so forth. And so I can tell them that with a small influence parameter, there's going to be little adoption no matter what, or a medium influence parameter, some adoption. With a very high influence parameter, there's full adoption. And with very high influence, there's quick full adoption, because we not only want to hit the whole market, but we want to hit the whole market sooner so that we can benefit from ongoing revenues. So the software shows you the diffusion curves, and it's nice for them to see these curves developing over time. This is the output of a simulation. So for a simulation with 8 targets, I got 389 adopters out of 400. Those were the parameters for the simulation. And then you have a file like this, time, ID, and whether the node has adopted or not. So that means that at time zero, node one did not adopt the product. At time zero, node six adopted the product. So a simple indicator for who adopted and who didn't. For all IDs, for all time, the students love this because not all of them are sufficiently very high tech savvy, and so they can just input this to Excel and actually do a number of things. So perhaps another quiz is, if I wanted to know how much profit do I make, how do I do that from this data? Well, it's just very easy. You just add over the third column, and that will tell you how many person periods you have with the product. And so that's very easy to find out how many people have adopted the product in how many time periods, and that's a proxy for the profit that the company is making. So that's pretty much what I have to show you. I'll just let you know that this works with sessions, so you can save sessions and come back and load sessions and see what's going on. You can export one simulation at a time, or all simulations that you have in memory at once. And because this is a little bit about big data today, about big data and about big networks, just to give you an idea that creating a network using preferential attachment with 100,000 nodes takes 40 seconds. And if you want to run a simulation in such a network, takes a little bit less than 2 hours, which means you cannot do it in the class, but you can do it as a homework. 2 hours is pretty nice. I think it's your average Netflix session, so you can set the software and go watch something. So this was made from my laptop with a broadband connection to the CMU campus. It's available from this link, the simulator. If you need to use it, you can email me and I'll set up the software for you. Everything that I described and much more is in the help file readily available from the software. Okay. Ali, you have a question?
Yeah.
No. So while we are working in a version of the software where each node has its own covariates, and those covariates shape whether I'm going to adopt the product or not. That's the first thing that we are working on right now. The second thing that we are working on right now that is also helpful for this kind of cases is that I adopt the product, but then at some point I just ditch the product. So here, the version that we have right now, you adopt the product, you will keep the product forever, right? But sometimes you're infected and sometimes you're cured. So for those cases, we are working on a situation in which we need to have a parallel model for going from 1 to 0 instead of just going from 0 to 1. My goal to bring this here today was to show you this is what we have, this is where we are. If there's some traction, we'll keep on developing. This is embryonic, but my experience is that for the type of students that we have in this class, even master students, it's really nice for them to see this diffusing. They can do these movies of things going through the network. And more importantly, they connect diffusion to properties of the network. And the software computes the properties of the network to you right away. Yeah?
So you said how do you motivate them?
Well, so actually, we start this course with Christensen's theory of disruption, which was already mentioned here today. And as we know, this theory has been under attack from many different places. And I end up the first model in the course telling them it's not about labeling things as disruptive or sustaining. It's understanding the features that make these things work or not work. And so the first thing that we go right there is, now we are impregnated with social network data. How can we use this data to make a difference? Because it's not whether it's sustaining or disruptive. It's who are the targets that you give the product to begin with. So this is like the marketish part of the course. Then we go talk to about platforms and so on and so forth. So this is one module on 3 or 4 modules that we tell the students we should be looking at these things to understand way better if something can be disruptive or sustaining. Might not be the word disruptive and sustaining as Christensen used in his original.
Just to follow up, do you find that the students that come into the mission program are ready for this stuff, or do you have to do a lot of stuff?
I think they're ready for this because we start with a star, with a network, with a ring and a buzz, and they understand this. Then we go through measures of centrality, and we use the software to, the first ones I ask them to actually compute by themselves. They're ready to do this. And then they understand the relationship to marketing and who the targets should be. This is a module in the course that works extremely well. So, thank you. Yeah, thank you.